One of the things that came from the emergency OPEC meeting was news from the Saudis that they would lower their prices to compete with renegade members of the oil alliance. That's good news for consumers, but bad news for the state of Oklahoma. Saudi oil is the strongest competition to domestic fuel, and it doesn't take an international analyst to realize that lower Saudi prices will mean lower prices for domestic fuel, and even greater revenue shortfalls for oil-producing states.
I think that in the event that those prices do drop, that somewhere down the line, depending upon how long they stay down, that we will have to make the appropriate adjustments to compensate for that. And so it'll be of very little consequence perhaps to the consumer, but it'll be of serious consequence to the state of Oklahoma and in its ability to finance its government.
For every dollar a barrel the price of oil drops, state revenues drop by $10 million. The Saudis are suggesting a cut of $5 or more. As far as the consumer is concerned, York says the slight decline in gasoline cost may be washed out by the new 5 cents a gallon gas tax. Charles Schnitzer, Action 4.
But I'm not used to going through this. I'm used to going from one job to another job. I've never been unemployed before or been laid off or anything like that before. And it's frustrating when you haven't been through this before and you really don't know what to expect. But when you come here and you see that everybody's going through the same thing, I really don't feel too bad about it.
The first stop for new state prison inmates is the Lexington Assessment and Reception Center. New arrivals are screened at the prison before being transferred to the institution where they'll serve their sentence. Lexington has been busy lately. Two inmates have been packed into nearly every single cell at the prison. The federal court overseeing Oklahoma's prison system has allowed doubling up, at least temporarily. But things got so busy at Lexington, corrections officials this month came close to placing three convicts per cell.
And my staff advised me that we were about to go to triple celling. And I said, no, we can't go to triple celling. The federal courts would find us certainly in contempt of court then. So we had to call the counties and to ask them to work with us by not sending prisoners and then fast track classification so that we could get those people out of the reception unit and then take people from the jails. All the sheriffs worked with us and cooperated. That's the reason you did not hear anything about it publicly. But we came within two or three hours of being triple celled.
The close brush with triple celling was a big topic at today's corrections board meeting. In a related matter, board members found out the corrections department is running out of cash. The department has asked the legislature for an extra $6 million to get through this fiscal year. One agency official predicted that if the department doesn't get the money by March, then it won't have the cash to pay its employees.
The two-headed monster of increasing inmate population and decreasing income can only be slain by the Oklahoma legislature. And if something isn't done soon, then the corrections department will have to face the prospect of laying off employees. And of course, that would only make things worse than they already are. Scott Wallace, Action 4 at the corrections department.
Wood-burning stoves have become very popular recently due to high utility bills. Sales of the stoves have taken off already this year, but so have something else, accidents. The Consumer Product Safety Commission reports that mostly wood stoves caused 140,000 fires and 290 deaths in 1981 alone. But the stoves aren't usually the problem. It's the way people use them. Steve Etchison purchased a wood-burning stove because of $200 a month electricity bills. He says if you handle them right, they're safe and very efficient.
You just don't let let the kids fool with it. So as far as safety, no, we're not worried about it. And just for the what we're doing on our electric heating, we're total electric here, and it hasn't come on. We've got the switch off, and we've never used it.
Government officials want to put instruction labels on the stoves to ensure safety, and that might be a good idea. Because if projections are correct, more and more people will be going to the wood-burning stove, increasing the chance for accidents. Kevin Ogle, Action 4.
Now it's talking pretty rough. You get nasty about it. Say tomorrow at 12 o'clock at noon, if they're not shut down, they're going to start throwing bricks, shooting tires down. So if I can get home by tonight, I'm going.
If the strike goes on, I'm going to shut down because what I'm hauling and what I'm doing is not worth taking a chance on my life. And I know these guys get awful nasty.
I just told them to, if they had temperature, to tell me, and then they all lined up and came in here, and they all had mostly above 100. And I just started calling parents, having them come pick them up. So by the end of the day, we were pretty well just a shell.
When you go to an auditorium to hear your favorite performer, the only thing worse than not being able to see the performance is not being able to hear it because of a hearing impairment. Well, that problem has been solved at the Oklahoma City Civic Center. There are many ways to transmit sound. The music at this recent Orion concert was sent through the air on an FM signal. The Civic Center is using something new in Oklahoma City called the phonic ear sound system. Now concertgoers with hearing impairments can place the phonic ear in their own ear and be able to hear the performance clearly. Civic Center officials encourage hearing impaired people to ask for the phonic ear when attending a show, and it comes in several forms.
This little unit here is the receiver, and it has a little clip where it can be placed on an individual's belt and worn inconspicuously. It has a volume control so that they can adjust the sound to whatever level is appropriate for their particular hearing problem. It also has an environmental sound switch so that they can turn this on and be able to hear individuals that are sitting next to them, or they can turn it off and just hear the performance. The receiver can be connected to any of the three attachments. It can be connected to a simple earphone set. This is available for people who do not have a hearing aid. Or it can be connected to a teleloop, which is for people with a hearing aid that also have a telephone switch on their hearing aid. Thirdly, it can be attached to a silhouette coil. This is used in conjunction with a hearing aid and is placed directly next to the hearing aid.
Gray says for those who have tried the phonic ear, the results have been good. Hearing impaired persons normally depended on loud songs to be performed. This used to be the only way many of them could hear bits and pieces of music. The phonic ear does not deliver in stereo, but it does deliver entertaining sounds. Ed Stewart, Action for the Civic Center.
Yes, I needed to check on some information. Might get some water and some
a lot of people come to Oklahoma City Hall with problems and expect quick answers. While employees follow city guidelines to find solutions, a citizen may perceive this as a runaround. This is a common problem for city workers. Oftentimes, it's a situation that leads to frustration for the citizen and the employee.
I haven't got anything done. I've got to have some water. I've been down here once already and went to this runaround, and I've come back and I want some action now.
What else do you think the public wants from you? I mean, haven't you often asked yourself that at 5 o'clock? Say, what do they want from me?
In hopes of coping better, it's back to school for 360 Oklahoma City employees for the next several weeks. All of the workers come in direct contact with the public, and sometimes the experience can be trying. The city is teaching these men and women to serve the public, even though some citizens can make being a public servant unbearable. Many of those attending the class think there are cases where people expect miracles from the city.
How would you talk to a citizen when their mind is made up when they first call you? Mm-hmm. They didn't pay their water bill in 3 months. Oh. They owe the bill, but yet and still, the city's a ripoff. How do you satisfy that customer?
We'll talk about
how would you
that.
Deal with it? Because the city is never right, and they're never wrong.
Hey.
We're the scapegoats.
You're right.
Okay, we're...
The class may point out to employees what are their strong and weak points when dealing with the public.
We're going to be doing a lot of self-assessment, and people will be able to identify their own strengths and weaknesses, which I feel will help a lot because it will allow them permission to say, maybe this part of the city work is not my bag. Maybe I really should look at something else.
Can I post-date you a check or something tomorrow?
No, we will not.
The city doesn't expect a 14-hour crash course to guarantee employees won't get burnt out in the future. But as instructor Taylor puts it, workers should realize this is not necessarily a fair world when it comes to being a public servant.
Well, if you don't want to help me, I don't need your help.
Ed Stewart, Action 4.
Greyhound enthusiasts all over the state of Oklahoma are banding together to get greyhound dogs like this one back to the state of Oklahoma to race.
The breeders are introducing legislation to allow greyhound racing and betting in the state. The horse racers' biggest worry, apparently, is that greyhound racing and horse racing will be in competition. But the greyhound breeders assure them that they will schedule all greyhound racing on the horse racers' off-season.
There are 270-something breeders of us here in Oklahoma wanting to help promote greyhound racing in the state. We think that it would be beneficial, bring in equal amount of revenue to the state as horse racing. And we are, quite frankly, tired of sending our dogs out of state and letting the other states earn the revenue. Besides, we only collect 35% on our dogs that we have to lease out to other states.
The word around the state capitol is that most lawmakers see no difference between betting on horse races and betting on dog races.
It has been estimated that if dog breeding is approved in Oklahoma, an estimated $10 million in revenue could be raised, a much needed contribution in these hard times. Sarah Pence, Action 4, Tallala.
May 27, 1981. A gunman pumped some pistol slugs into Tulsa tycoon Roger Wheeler. Law enforcement officials agree the murder was ordered by organized crime. They believe an Oklahoma County man was involved in the hit. 3 months before that murder, Texas hitman Clifford Henry Bowen was convicted of the contract killings of three Oklahoma City residents. Authorities claim Bowen was acting on orders from organized crime.
Oklahoma County District Attorney Bob Macy points to these two incidents as evidence mobsters are trying to muscle their way into Oklahoma.
One of the things I asked for from the legislature was what we call a RICO statute. That stands for racketeer-influenced corrupt organizations. That statute allows the federal government to go in any place they can prove an ongoing criminal conspiracy and seize all of the property that's involved, whether it's businesses, stock and corporation, houses, whatever, and forfeit that to the government. So in effect, when you take out that criminal, you wipe him out financially.
Macy warns that motorcycle gangs have taken over several Oklahoma City topless bars. He says the clubs have become havens for drug dealers. In the past, where drugs have led the way, organized crime has quickly followed. Scott Wallace, Action 4.
It spread like that. I mean, one minute my feet were on fire, and the next minute I can't get out my back door.
Well, I think the bottom line is, what are they going to do with all these farms if and when they do foreclose on them? The number of farmers is way down and decreasing every year. And what the answer is, what are you going to do with the farms if the government or forecloses, or even the banker? He doesn't want to work the farm.
American agriculture is in danger of bankruptcy. That's according to U.S. Senator David Boren. But that's not news to Lee Ray Stiles of Cushing and other farmers' union members. They know there's a crisis in agriculture. This group fully supports Boren's efforts to prevent forced farm foreclosures.
They're predicting things will be better in 85, but I think it's one of the most important things they could do at this time.
How about yourself?
Definitely we have to have it. Absolutely.
Why do you say this?
How can we wait till 85 when we're already in awful bad shape? We need it now. 85, we won't be here.
The state director of the Farmers' Home Administration tells Action 4 he would oppose a blanket moratorium on farm foreclosures, but Larry Stevenson says the FHA is re-emphasizing to its field people to do everything they can do to help the farmer having a problem. That includes allowing the farmer not to have to pay interest on his loan for a time and rescheduling the loan period. Ben McCain, Action 4.
I saw what was a very bad fire. In fact, I would have taken a nickel for the whole block. Well, the roof was falling in on the Ben Franklin store and the sparks were going about 50 feet in the air with a lot of electricity and all that kind of stuff.
You got help from what surrounding communities, and they were really a blessing, weren't they?
Sepulpa, Drumright, Manford, Osage Oil, and Halliburton's. We wouldn't have made it without them.
Picture of what their true love should look like. With the help of videotape equipment, that's what One Computer Dating Service does for its members. After a 200-question personality sheet is filled out and fed into a computer, the companion seeker is interviewed on camera. This captures the style and mannerisms as the person actually is. Next, the computer makes potential matches, and the hopeful client is allowed to view videotape interviews of prospects.
Why your family?
Basketball. Football. I play tennis and racquetball.
A lot of people say, why should I go to a dating service? They're afraid only losers are there. Well, that's not what we have found at all. We have people, very high quality professional people in here who are frustrated with the system. And there is a problem out there, a very limited number of ways to meet other single people. A lot of us have had bad experiences with blind dates, so this is like you almost know the person before you even meet them.
I can make you feel. Be it computers or videotape, this is what the end result is supposed to be. It appears technology has made a big step toward finding a true love.
So I promise you tonight that you will always be the lady in my life.
Ed Stewart, Action 4, Northwest Oklahoma City.
Just for an example, if we think our phone bill is going high today, if we didn't have communication satellites, it would be skyrocketing today because they are the one that's providing us with the mass media of communicating today across our nation. Not only that, of course, what we're looking at is a continuation of satellites that will be looking back at our Earth in the case of Earth resources, agricultural inventory, forestry inventory, and not only that, of course, looking at insect and disease in its early stages to be able to identify it to where this would give you in the future a chance to confine it and eradicate it instead of waiting and see it with the naked eye as we do today, which means the damage has already been done.
Thank you.
Armed robberies in Oklahoma City are keeping police busier than ever before. The trend has become very apparent. In the last couple of years, the armed robbery rate has increased an average of 20%. Just comparing January of last year to January 1983, the statistics speak for themselves. There were 5 robberies a day reported in 1982, and now at least 8 robberies occur each day in the city. That's a 30% increase. Police say hard times is partly responsible for robberies becoming a bigger problem.
Part of it, at least, is due to the economy. I guess times are tough, and people think they can go in and steal a purse or just hold up a convenience store, fast food restaurant, and get some money. The thing is, they're not getting that much money, and the risks they're taking is too great for the amount of money they're getting.
Hanneman says most robberies are committed by people with previous felony convictions or by those on parole. Oklahoma City Police do have ongoing seminars like this one to show citizens and businesses how to avoid being robbed. Purse snatching is said to be another crime going at a faster rate than most others. While Oklahoma City Police are successful in catching many robbers, they stress the key to a lower crime rate is still prevention. Ed Stewart, Action 4.
The word the Senate committee heard was both good and not so good. The court-appointed factfinder told the senators Oklahoma has made great progress in corrections, though there are some areas that still need work, and he suggested programs being used in other states. Many of the programs were the ones Department Director Larry Meachum has been offering for as long as he has been in Oklahoma. The factfinder says there is one particular blemish against Oklahoma's record.
In many respects, Oklahoma had gone from one of the worst prison systems in the country to one of the best, and in many areas it still is among the very best. But overcrowding has overshadowed a great deal of that.
Corrections Director Larry Meachum says he believes Oklahoma could get out from under the federal court order now if it weren't for the overcrowding situation. But the prison populations continue to grow faster than the system does, and the state is going to have to find solutions soon. Charles Schnetzer, Action 4.
The bipartisan compromise has 3 basic elements. First, it would provide $4 billion in accelerated expenditures for needed federal construction and repair projects. These projects, directly and indirectly, could provide as many as 470,000 jobs. Second, we would provide $2.9 billion to fund the supplementary employment insurance, or unemployment insurance, I should say, the program through the end of the year. And third, we're seeking $300 million in additional humanitarian relief for those who are in serious distress.
this Sunday, many of the FFA members will be attending church services as a group to actually dedicate this week, which is National FFA Week, to the activities which they will be doing this weekend throughout the year.
What does this mean to the state FFA chapter and other chapters across the country?
This means an excellent opportunity to let those supporters, those friends of the FFA that help these young people, know how much they appreciate them. And many of our activities that will be going on this week are simply to tell those people and let them know what these young people in Oklahoma and the nation are doing.
Your official title, John, with the FFA?
Executive Secretary of the Oklahoma FFA Association.
Fairly new in the position?
Since July.
Tell me about it. What do you do?
My basic job is to work with the State FFA Association and the activities. We have many activities and programs that are actually complement the vocational agriculture program and help the students with demonstrate the skills and experiences that they learn in the high school vocational agriculture classroom. Also, I am very fortunate to have the opportunity to work with the state FFA officers. Throughout the year, they plan different leadership activities and help other FFA members bring out the qualities in them, which is a major emphasis of the FFA, is to work with these students preparing to enter agriculture career and industry, develop their qualities of leadership.
You seem to enjoy your job?
Very much. It's always a challenge when you get to work with young people that are dedicated and have goals set and watch them fulfill those goals and the struggles they go through in reaching those goals, but it is a very challenging and rewarding job.